I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. I wish I could break all the chains holding me. I wish I could say all the things that I should say. Say them loud, say them clear, for the whole round world to hear. I wish I could share all the love that's in my heart. Remove all the bars that keep us apart. I wish you could know what it means to be me. Then you'd see and agree that every man should be free. I wish I could give all I love.
And not well, main speaker, Comrade Keith Bennett.
We see it as our revolutionary duty to pay tribute to Comrade Kim Jong Il. In our view, he was not only the great leader of the Korean people, but also one of the most prominent statesmen and international political figures and leaders of the last part of the 20th century and the first part of the 21st. And he was also, in our view, one of the greatest and most outstanding leaders of the international communist movement, not only at the present time, but in the entire history of our movement. Now, two things have been witnessed in the world since Comrade Kim Jong-il's untimely death. One, of course, is the vast outpouring of grief that we have seen among the people of the Democratic People's Republic of Korea. However, we have not only seen that, but for those who look at those media reports that are available, which is not particularly in our media, there have also been considerable expression of grief from wide sections of society in South Korea, including the widow of the former president of South Korea, who took part in the North-South summit with Kim Jong-il in Pyongyang, and the head of the Hyundai company in South Korea, a well-known global company which has over the years conducted business relations with the DPRK. But alongside the outpouring of grief in North Korea, the expressions of condolence and sadness from wide sections of South Korean society, there have also been widespread tributes to Comrade Kim Jong-il from the representatives of the majority of humanity, which I will outline in a bit more detail a little later on. On the other hand, we've seen, and Comrade Apal has mentioned this, the imperialist parasites, those who have the blood of millions of innocent people on their hands, and their paid scribes, who have been falling over themselves to try and outdo each other in finding bad things to say about Comrade Kim Jong-il. And just as in his lifetime, no statement has been too lurid, and no allegation has been too risible to be excised from our media here. Now, some of our opponents or critics, if you like, on the left, have often accused us of paying too much attention to Korea in our party's work. And they will say, why are you always having meetings about Kim Il-sung, and why are you always having meetings about Kim Jong-il, and think that this is something to sneer about. But this week, Kim Jong-il and Korea have dominated the front pages of the Financial Times, The Times, The Guardian, The Independent. The story of the death of Kim Jong-il even made it to the front page of that august journal of record, The Sun. So, comrades, there is no difference between us and our class enemies on the importance of Korea and of Kim Jong-il. The difference is, what stand do you take about it? In the words of the old saying of the working class movement, which side are you on? Now, what we've seen here is, I think, another example of the decadence of modern imperialism, in the death of Kim Jong-il, we see them once again casting aside even the most elementary norms of diplomacy, which in fact was a game whose rules were largely written by them in the first place, but which now they seek to cast aside. We see in the reactions from leading imperialist politicians to the death of Comrade Kim Jong Il the same kind of arrogance that is presented when we hear of leaders in this part of the world saying that the leader of Libya or the leader of Syria have lost their legitimacy and stepped down. So that, for example, we have this statement from William Hague.
Hope, of course, that it will be a turning point for North Korea. We hope that their new leadership will recognize that engagement with the international community offers the best prospect of improving the lives of the North Korean people. And we encourage North Korea to work for peace and security in the region and take the steps necessary to allow the resumption of the six-party talks on denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula.
Now, Hapal has made a certain comment about the international community, and I will also return to that in a minute. However, whatever one thinks of William Hague's statement, the most disgusting statement from a political leader I could find is that from the Prime Minister of Canada, Stephen Harper. Now, I must, first of all, I must just in passing say that unlike Kim Jong Il, who probably not many, how many, one sort of wonders how many people outside of Canada have actually heard of Stephen Harper. The Canadian Prime Minister said as follows: Kim Jong-il will be remembered as the leader of a totalitarian regime who violated the basic rights of the North Korean people for nearly two decades. We hope his passing brings positive change, allowing the people of North Korea to emerge from six decades of isolation, oppression and misery. The regime's reckless decisions have resulted in North Korea being an impoverished nation and a country isolated from the international community again, because of its dangerous nuclear proliferation and ballistic missile programs. At this critical juncture, we urge North Korea to close this sad chapter in its history and to work once more towards promoting both the well-being of its people and stability on the Korean Peninsula. And this statement is made despite the fact that Ottawa and Pyongyang have had diplomatic relations at ambassadorial level for some 10 years. And despite the fact that, needless to say, the Korean people have never done anything against the Canadian people or anything to harm them or upset their interests. Whereas the Canadian ruling class took part in the dirty war against Korea between 1950 and 1953 and is today taking part in the dirty wars of Libya against Libya and Afghanistan. So, when we see these comments about Kim Jong-il, we're reminded of something that Chairman Mao said once, when he said that to be attacked by the enemy is not a bad thing, but a good thing. And in fact, it is better that they portray us as completely negative and without a single virtue, because this will mean that we are doing a good job in our work. George W. Bush was reputed once to have asked about the Muslim section of the world's population, why do they hate us so much? Well, we're slightly more intelligent, I hope, than George W. Bush. We know that the imperialists and their followers did not hate Kim Jong-il because of the supposed size of his DVD collection or his supposed taste in food and drink. Such things hardly concern them when it comes to the potentates and puppets that imperialism maintains throughout the oppressed nations of the world. It was years ago that Comrade Stalin said that for the capitalists, their happiness is based on our misery. And it's against that background that I want to use most of the time of, that I have to focus on two points. One, to expose, as Hapal has already mentioned, what the likes of William Hague and Stephen Harper have to say about the supposed international community, and to demonstrate that it is in fact not Kim Jong-il and the DPRK who are isolated in the real world. And secondly, that the reason why the imperialists hated Kim Jong Il, and why not only the Korean people, but our party and all revolutionary movements around the world loved him, are in fact the same. That he was an outstanding and dedicated and tireless leader of the working class who devoted his entire life to the revolution. The international tributes to Comrade Kim Jong Il are just starting to be published over the last 2 to 3 days, so it's not yet possible to have an exhaustive survey of them. Nevertheless, there is more than enough material already available to illustrate the points I want to make. The leaders of the People's Republic of China, which, after all, is a quarter of the world's population, wrote as follows. Upon hearing the shocking news that Kim Jong-il, General Secretary of the Workers' Party of Korea, Chairman of the National Defense Commission of the DPRK, and Supreme Commander of the Korean People's Army passed away to our sorrow, we express with bitterest grief most profound condolences and sincere sympathy to all the Korean people. Kim Jong-il was the great leader of the WPK and the DPRK. He devoted energy all his life to the great cause of the Korean people, for building Korean-style thriving socialist nation, and performed immortal historical feats. Kim Jong-il was a close friend of the Chinese people. It was with great enthusiasm that he carried forward and developed the traditional Sino-DPRK friendship, provided and cultivated by the revolutionaries of the elder generation of the two countries, forged close relations with the Chinese leaders, and dynamically promoted the steady development of the relations of good neighborliness, friendship, and cooperation between China and the DPRK. The Chinese party, government, and people profoundly grieve over the demise of Kim Jong-il, and the Chinese people will always miss him. Though he passed away all of a sudden, he will live in the hearts of the Korean people forever. We are convinced that the Korean people will overcome sorrow and display strength under the leadership of Kim Jong-un, united close around the WPK, true to the behests of Kim Jong-il, and make uninterrupted advances to build a thriving socialist nation and achieve lasting peace on the Korean Peninsula. China and the DPRK are linked with each other with a mountain and rivers, and are sharing weal and woe. It is the consistent policy of the Chinese party and government to steadily consolidate and develop the traditional Sino-DPRK friendly and cooperative relations. We are convinced that the friendship between the two parties, countries and peoples of China and the DPRK will surely continue to grow stronger thanks to the concerted efforts of both sides. The Chinese people will, as always, stand by the side of the Korean people. Kim Jong-il is immortal. On two successive days, the top leaders of the of China visited the DPRK embassy in Beijing to pay condolences. And commenting on this, the Korean Central News Agency summarized this as follows. They said, "All the members of the Standing Committee of the Political Bureau of the Central Committee of the Communist Party of China visited the DPRK embassy in Beijing to mourn his demise in bitterest grief. This clearly represents the highest tribute of the collective leadership of China to Kim Jong-il, and the invariable support of the party and people of China to the Workers' Party of Korea and the Korean people." On hearing the news, Cuba proclaimed 3 days of national mourning for Kim Jong-il from December 20th to 22nd, during which throughout Cuba, flags were hoisted at half-mast on all public buildings and all military institutions. And like his Chinese counterparts, Raul Castro also went to the Korean embassy in Havana to personally convey his condolences. And the same was done by the senior leaders of the Vietnamese Communist Party. From Venezuela, President Hugo Chavez issued a statement expressing most profound condolences over the demise of leader Kim Jong-il, and expressing feelings of deep solidarity with the people of the DPRK, voicing his belief that the Korean people will surely achieve the prosperity of the country. Similar sentiments were expressed by the revolutionary government of Nicaragua, where it was announced that President Daniel Ortega had sent his profound condolences for the death of the dear leader, Kim Jong Il. In Nepal, the Prime Minister of Nepal, from the Unified Communist Party, Maoist, said as follows, "Dear leader, Kim Jong Il's death has been a great loss to the people of DPRK. In his death, Nepal has lost a great friend too." From Palestine, Nayef Hawatmi, the leader of the Democratic Front for the Liberation of Palestine, the DFLP, wrote, "Upon hearing the sad news that comrade Kim Jong-il, great internationalist leader, passed away to the people's regret in the middle of his tour for field guidance, I express deep condolences to you and the leadership and people of your country, representing the comradely, internationalist and militant solidarity on behalf of myself and the leadership and comrades of the Democratic Front for the Liberation of Palestine and the people of Palestine." The President of Namibia wrote, "Comrade Kim Jong-il will always be remembered for his distinguished and exemplary services to the people of the Democratic People's Republic of Korea. He endeared himself to the people of Africa and all emerging nations with his steadfast commitment to their liberation and indeed to the struggle for freedom and independence of the oppressed people of Namibia." Similar sentiments were expressed by the President of Tanzania, who said that Kim Jong-il will be remembered as a leader who showed interest in Africa and will live as the great friend of Tanzania and Africa. From Zimbabwe, and we have the Guardian to thank for, admittedly with their customary sarcastic spin, from Zimbabwe, the secretary of the ZANU-PF party said to the Zimbabwean media about Kim Jong-il, "He was a lovely man whom we associated with. He was our great friend, and we are not ashamed of being associated with him. We got a lot of help from him as his country trained our army, and they also built our Heroes Acre, a monument to our national heroes that we are very proud of. It was a very good relationship that we shall always cherish. We worked together well." From Russia, President Medvedev wrote, "Allow me to express my deep condolences to you and the leadership of the DPRK and its people over the demise of Kim Jong-il. In Russia, His Excellency Kim Jong-il is well known as the leader of a friendly state who did a lot for the strengthening and development of the traditional Russia-DPRK good neighbourly relations. I am sure that this line, in the interests of our two countries and peoples, will be inherited by the new leadership of the DPRK." And the former king of Cambodia, Prince Sihanouk, who is now the sole surviving leader of those who attended the 1955 Afro-Asian Solidarity Conference in Bandung, said, "Sharing the deepest grief with the heroic Korean people, we extend our condolences. The demise of Kim Jong-il is a great loss of an outstanding leader to the Korean nation and people. We appreciate the exploits of Kim Jong-il, greatest leader of the Korean nation and people. We will never forget the matchless great support given to us by Kim Jong-il, just as His Excellency Generalissimo Kim Il-sung rendered multifarious support to us. Kim Jong-il made great contributions to boosting the fraternal and close ties of friendship between the peoples of our two countries. His exploits will shine forever." So, for us, for our party, we are quite clear with whom we would rather be associated. We would rather be associated with the leaders and peoples of China, Cuba, Vietnam, Nepal, Palestine, Venezuela, Nicaragua, Zimbabwe, and other anti-imperialist countries than with the leaders of the United States, Britain, France, Japan, and Canada. I now want to highlight just a few points as to why we consider Comrade Kim Jong-il to have been such an outstanding revolutionary comrade, communist, such an outstanding revolutionary communist leader and such a close comrade in arms of our own party. And I will do so by simply by quoting from four of Comrade Kim Jong Il's own works, works that were written over a period of 1983 to 1996. I think it is quite fitting to let Comrade Kim Jong Il's words speak for themselves. His works are too little known in the working class movement here, and we will do more to promote and to publicise them, not only this evening, but in an ongoing way in our future work. I will start with the latest of the ones I'm going to quote, though I will return to chronological order. I will start with the one from 1996, because it is not only important in terms of what it says in general, but it actually speaks a great deal as to why we are holding this meeting tonight. This article, which Kim Jong Il wrote, is entitled "Respecting the Forerunners of the Revolution is a Noble Moral Obligation of Revolutionaries." And in setting out this point of view, Comrade Kim Jong Il actually speaks to why we are holding our meeting tonight and why our party holds him in such esteem. Kim Jong Il wrote, "Our people respect the revolutionaries of the previous generations as their revolutionary seniors, set great store by their spirit and achievements in the struggle, and are carrying faithfully forward and developing the revolutionary cause pioneered by them. This is a noble morality developed by our people from generation to generation, as well as a basic factor that ensures the steady, triumphant development of our revolution, even in the most complex situations. The history of the world socialist movement provides the serious lesson that a revolution advances victoriously when revolutionary forefathers are respected and their accomplishments are preserved and developed, and that a revolution is abandoned and frustrated when revolutionary predecessors are betrayed and their accomplishments are negated." In several countries that had built socialism in the past, opportunists occupying the leadership of the parties and states defamed their revolutionary predecessors and obliterated their achievements. In consequence of their traitorous acts, the reputation of communists has been damaged, the image of socialism clouded, and the socialist system itself has ended in collapse. Holding revolutionary seniors in esteem means putting forward in every way the revolutionaries who devoted everything to the struggle, championing and preserving their revolutionary ideas and achievements, and carrying forward and developing those ideas and achievements. In this same article, Comrade Kim Jong Il made some important remarks about revisionism. And it is in the struggle against revisionism that revises away the revolutionary essence of the communist movement that our own party was born and developed. He wrote that historically, in opposing socialism, imperialists and renegades from the revolution have directed their attacks on the leaders of the working class and the revolutionaries of the preceding generations. This is because socialism was pioneered and has triumphed thanks to the guidance of the leader and the self-sacrificing struggle of the revolutionaries of the preceding generations, and because the dignity of socialism is associated with their honour. Modern revisionists and socialist renegades have caused socialism to degenerate and collapse by disgracing the leader and their revolutionary elders, and by obliterating their exploits. The process of the degeneration and collapse of socialism began with the emergence of modern revisionism, which vilified the leader and revolutionary pioneers and distorted and debased the revolutionary ideas of the working class. Because of modern revisionists, socialism began to go off the track and crumble from within. Its collapse was due to the policy of reform and restructuring pursued by socialist renegades who denied and obliterated every historical achievement of socialism. Opportunists and socialist renegades slandered the leaders of the working class and debased the sacred revolutionary struggle and great revolutionary achievements of their revolutionary predecessors. They destroyed socialism and revived capitalism. This is a most despicable counter-revolutionary crime that betrayed the revolution under the pressure of imperialism, an immoral perfidy that discarded loyalty to the revolution and trampled underfoot elementary human morals. Comrade Kim Jong Il, in the same article, referred to the importance of internationalism. He said the cause of independence for the popular masses, the cause of socialism, is a national and at the same time an international cause. The Korean revolutionaries are genuine internationalists. They respect the revolutionaries, anti-imperialist fighters, anti-fascist fighters, progressive figures, and revolutionary people of all countries, irrespective of their nationality, and duly appreciate their achievements. He then goes on to say some words which are equally applicable to the things that have been said in the imperialist world about him, particularly in recent days. He said, "Our party and people respect Marx, Engels, Lenin and Stalin as the leaders of the working class and speak highly of their distinguished services. Reflecting the demands and aspirations of the working class, Marx and Engels, the first leaders of the working class, developed socialism from a utopian concept to a science and started the socialist and communist movement. Lenin inherited and developed Marxism to meet the change of the times and won the victory of the October Socialist Revolution by organizing and mobilizing the working class. Stalin, succeeding to the cause of Lenin, built the first young socialist state into a world power and defended the socialist fatherland from the fascist invasion, leading the army and the people. In their day, Marx, Engels, Lenin and Stalin represented the aspirations and demands of the exploited working masses, and the cause of socialism was inseparably linked with their names. The fact that imperialists and the traitors to the revolution viciously defamed the leaders of the working class and abused their leadership as dictatorship or infringement on human rights only proves that the leaders of the working class were zealous champions of the people's interests and enjoyed their trust and support, and that they were steadfast communist revolutionaries who held fast to the revolutionary principle without compromising with the enemies of the revolution." In contrast to this, he talked again about revisionism as follows. He said, the opportunists and socialist renegades distorted and defamed Marxism-Leninism and disgraced its authors. Modern revisionists emasculated the revolutionary principles of Marxism-Leninism to please the imperialists, and thus distorted and corrupted the revolutionary ideology of the working class. The socialist renegades, claiming that the socialist ideal itself was wrong, denied the revolutionary idea of the working class outright. The idea that denies the working class revolutionary idea cannot be anything but bourgeois ideology. The traitors claimed that they were carrying out reform and restructuring for democracy and economic welfare, gainsaying the revolutionary idea of the working class. However, real life has clearly shown that their theory was nothing but a reactionary theory for destroying socialism and reviving capitalism. Our people respect not only the leaders of the working class, but also the revolutionaries and peoples of all countries who have fought heroically for the socialist cause. We remember the great revolutionary struggles of the peoples in many countries who have rendered distinguished services in the socialist cause. We highly appreciate their historical achievements. Our party and people oppose and denounce all manner of counter-revolutionary plots and traitorous acts that defame and debase the struggles and achievements of revolutionary forerunners who contributed to the socialist cause. Although the opportunists and the socialist renegades defaced the honour of the leaders of the working class and the revolutionary pioneers, they can never wipe out their names and their worthy achievements from history. Just as socialism is alive in people's minds and is opening up the path to a new victory in spite of temporary twists and turns, so the honour and accomplishments of the leaders of the working class and the revolutionary forefathers will be respected forever by the people as the socialist movement advances. The next article, I'll now take the remaining three in chronological order. The next, and they all came at, I think, at important periods of recent history. The first article was published by Comrade Kim Jong Il in 1983, and it was entitled "Let Us Advance Under the Banner of Marxism-Leninism and the Juche Idea." And this article was written by him to mark two anniversaries, the 160th birthday of Karl Marx, and as well as the centenary of his death. And the important, as I say, this article was written in 1983. It was a period where there was struggle within the communist movements because there was a great upsurge in the anti-imperialist struggle in various parts of the world. For example, in Central America, where you had revolution in Nicaragua and Grenada, revolutionary wars in El Salvador and so on, and the intensification of the liberation struggle in Southern Africa. And there was considerable debate and struggle within the communist movement and among the socialist countries as to how to respond to these developments. And the part I want to just highlight in this is where Comrade Kim Jong Il explains how communists have to be anti-imperialist. He wrote in 1983, "The important task at present in completing the revolutionary cause of the working class pioneered by Marx is to oppose imperialism and promote the cause of independence for the world. The struggle against capitalism and imperialism, which has lasted for a long time on the international arena, is still going on and is getting more intense. Capitalism and imperialism are the last exploiting systems which trample upon the aspirations of the masses for independence in human history, and are the most ferocious oppressive systems which combine class domination with national oppression. Imperialism has now turned into modern imperialism, based on state monopoly capitalism, and it has become more aggressive and brutal than ever before. It is flagrantly challenging the oppressed popular masses in their cause of national liberation, independence, and socialism. The imperialists are clinging to neocolonialism and obstinately pursuing the policy of plundering and subjugating other nations by more covert and crafty methods. US-led modern imperialism, though on the decline, is making desperate efforts to save itself from ruin. Particularly as the general crisis of capitalism deepens, the imperialists are not only repressing harshly the revolutionary advance of the working class and the working masses in their own countries, but also intensifying the acts of aggression and subversion against socialist countries and the international communist movement under the banner of anti-communism. So long as imperialism exists, domination and plunder will not cease. And as long as imperialist domination and plunder exist, there is bound to be the revolutionary struggle of the working class and the masses of the people to oppose them. If imperialism is to be ultimately destroyed and the victory of the world revolution is to be won, the anti-imperialist, anti-US struggle should be intensified. Apart from this struggle, it would be inconceivable to win and consolidate national independence, hasten the victory of socialism and communism, prevent war, and ensure world peace and security. What is of primary importance in strengthening the anti-imperialist, anti-US struggle is for socialist countries and communist and workers' parties to maintain an anti-imperialist stand and intensify the struggle against international imperialism." And he further wrote that in an attempt to subjugate newly independent countries again, "The US imperialists are now bringing massive aggressive forces into the major zones of resources and areas of strategic importance under the pretext of protecting concessions and security, and are making frantic efforts to take hold of the third world countries politically, economically and militarily in the guise of cooperation and protection. Under the banner of anti-imperialism and anti-colonialism, the Asian, African and Latin American peoples should wage daring struggles to oppose imperialism and defend independence, and thus carry out the tasks of anti-imperialist national liberation revolution thoroughly. The peoples of different parts of the world, which are still under the control of imperialism, colonialism, and racism, should conduct all manners of vigorous revolutionary struggles, including armed struggle, to drive out imperialists and achieve the decolonization and independence of their countries. The world's progressive people should actively support and encourage them in their struggle, both morally and materially." Now, what I just want to say about this, and it applies to many of the, you know, the other points to be outlined, is that how these words are not only were they very relevant at their time, as I say, this was written in 1983, but they're in fact even more relevant to today's situation. And I think this shows that the great prescience with which Comrade Kim Jong Il actually observed the developments in the international situation. The next article of his, which was actually a talk to senior officials of the Workers' Party of Korea, that I want to highlight, comes from 1987, and the title of this work is Let Us March Forward Dynamically Along the Road of Socialism and Communism Under the Unfurled Banner of the Anti-Imperialist Struggle. Now, as I say, this article, this talk, is from 1987. In other words, it is 2 years into the period of Gorbachev's leadership in the Soviet Union, and so obviously a period where revolutionaries like those in Korea were becoming more and more concerned about what was happening and how they should respond to it. And that is reflected clearly in the very opening words of this talk, where he says, "The general situation in the revolution at present is very complicated. An analysis of the developments in the international arena shows that there are serious problems concerning the destiny not only of our revolution, but also of the world revolution." He speaks here clearly of what the Gorbachev leadership was doing in the Soviet Union and a number of other countries. But he makes the point that the main emphasis has to be placed, again he makes the point that what is most important is to in dealing with this problem is to understand the true nature of imperialism. He said, "In order to assess the present revolutionary situation correctly and maintain a revolutionary stand, we must above all else have a proper understanding of the real features of contemporary imperialism and its fate." He goes on to deal with a whole number of these. I want to mention because they are so relevant, so important to our struggle and our situation. This is an important part of why we pay tribute to Comrade Kim Jong Il, not simply because he was the leader of a far-off country, but because he was a revolutionary leader who addressed the problems of the entire world, including our part of the world. Kim Jong Il, talking about the surveying some of the recent history of imperialism, he says that the imperialists could not help being extremely alarmed at the rapidly growing socialist forces and the upsurge of the working class movement and the national liberation movement in the colonies. That is why they have devised new and more cunning techniques of ruling and crafty methods of plundering to weaken the influence of socialism and appease the working class movement and national liberation movements in the colonies. The imperialists were keenly aware of the fact that they would not be able to maintain the capitalist system unless the working class movement in their own countries was undermined. So they brought up large numbers of labour aristocrats while striving to conceal capitalist exploitation and to subdue the resistance of the working masses through unemployment and poverty. He also said that in words, although written in 1987, that could apply equally to what we see with the what is happening between the Eurozone and the United States in particular. He pointed out that although at the time imperialism was largely united in a system controlled by the United States, that inter-imperialist rivalries and contradictions would surely re-emerge. He said the contradictions and antagonism between the imperialist powers will be further exacerbated in the future. Though the imperialist powers are now collaborating with each other in an attempt to maintain their position of monopoly, there is no doubt that their interests will conflict with each other and the contradictions between them will become aggravated as their markets grow narrower and the way to the growth of capital and of making money reaches a dead end. He also pointed out, in words again, which I think are extremely relevant to what is happening in the world today, that the increased aggression of imperialism is strategically a sign of its weakness, not its strength. He said, whenever imperialism faces a crisis, its reactionary and aggressive nature increases and it makes desperate efforts to maintain its existence. The frenzied efforts of the imperialists are not an expression of their strength. They reveal their vulnerability. The more reactionary the imperialists become, and the more frenzied are the efforts they make, the more the people will be awakened to revolutionary awareness, and the day of the collapse of imperialism will draw nearer. It is an indisputable fact that the end of contemporary imperialism is nigh, and it is historically inevitable that imperialism will perish and socialism triumph. He then goes on immediately to make some important points about the composition of the working class in the imperialist countries. He said, however, imperialism will not fall of its own accord. It can be defeated only by the revolutionary struggle of the working masses led by the working class. Building up the motive force of the revolution is decisive in destroying imperialism and winning victory in the revolution. In particular, it is important to strengthen the working class party, the vanguard detachment of the revolution, and to enhance its role. If we are to strengthen the revolutionary forces, we must correctly analyse and appraise the situation, appraise the changes that have taken place in social and class composition. Since the end of the Second World War, social and class composition in the capitalist countries has undergone a great change. As the mechanisation and automation of production has been promoted with the advance of technology in the developed capitalist countries, so the number of people who engage in physical labour has been considerably reduced, whereas the number of those who do technical and mental labour has increased rapidly, and they have become the overwhelming majority of the working people. It is a law that as society progresses, so the technical and cultural standard of the workers improves, and the number of intellectuals increases. Certainly it is true that the rapid growth in the number of intellectuals greatly influences the working people towards petty bourgeois ideology. Particularly in a capitalist society where systematic revolutionary education is impossible, it is unavoidable that many intellectuals are tainted with bourgeois and petty bourgeois ideas. Therefore, it is difficult to win them over to the revolution. But we cannot say that the change in social and class composition has weakened the social and class bases of the communist and workers' parties, or created unfavourable conditions for the socialist revolution. Neither the working people engaged in technical labour, nor those in mental labour, are owners of the means of production. There are some differences between them and physical labourers in their technical and cultural levels and in their working conditions, but there is an essential community between them in that they are all employed and paid by capitalists. Today, the number of working people, the conventional working masses, plus the newly emerged technical and mental labourers employed by the capitalists, accounts for 80 to 90% of the working populations in the developed capitalist countries. This shows that the social and class basis of the communist and workers' parties has, far from being weakened, actually been strengthened. The point at issue is how the communist and workers' parties should conduct political work to make the broad working masses revolutionary and win them over to suit the change in social and class composition. So here he talks about the capitalists those employed by the capitalists accounting for 80 to 90% of the working population, something which almost prefigures the we are the 99% of the Occupy Wall Street movement. Finally, I want to refer briefly to an article that he published in the Theoretical Journal of the Workers' Party of Korea in March 1993. The title of this work is Abuses of Socialism Are Intolerable. Again, the significance of this date is that it's 2 years before, 2 years after the collapse of the Soviet Union, which had unleashed not only a material setback to the cause of the working class internationally, but also a ferocious and anti-communist ideological offensive throughout the world, an anti-communist ideological offensive that is still going on, as we see in the whole attempt to rewrite even the history of the Second World War, and which is in fact also again reflected in imperialism and its media's attitude to Comrade Kim Jong Il himself. And in this article, one of the points I just wish to pull out is where he talks about the reasons for the cause of the collapse of socialism. And he says, unless ideological education and an ideological campaign are conducted to put an end to the abuse of power and bureaucracy, they will be fostered and grow and not disappear. If the abuse of power and bureaucracy are allowed to grow in socialist society, they will alienate the popular masses from the party and state, and the enemies of socialism will exploit this. The situation of those countries in which socialism has collapsed shows this. In every country, the people demanded socialism free from the abuse of power and bureaucracy. They did not demand capitalism. But in some countries, the party and government were discredited in the eyes of the people due to the abuse of power and bureaucracy. Taking advantage of this, acts of betrayal were committed in order to instigate people to oppose the socialist ruling parties and socialist power by misleading them with the preposterous slander that socialism was totalitarianism, and with the promise that they would be provided with humane and democratic socialism. What the people have got as a result of the collapse of socialism is not humane and democratic socialism, but capitalism, under which exploitation, oppression and social inequality are dominant, and every type of crime and social evil prevails. In those countries where socialism collapsed and capitalism was revived, the abuse of power and bureaucracy have not disappeared, but have become institutionalized and legitimized, and are now socially prevalent. He writes, socialism provides the people with a rich and cultured life. The long-cherished desire of the people to live free from any worries can only be realized in a socialist society in which the party and the state take responsible care of the people's lives. In a capitalist society, a carefree life for the working people is inconceivable. In this society, even those who are fairly well-to-do are always fearful of sudden bankruptcy, job loss, and poverty. Does that not indeed encapsulate the situation of that we face in this country today? So, just in these articles, the quotes I've presented, I feel it gives the lie to so much that is presented as though that this was that Kim Jong Il represented something mysterious, that Korea represented an isolated country. What he actually wrote about showed a man who was very well in touch with history, was very well in touch with the realities of not only of his own country, but of countries throughout the world, including countries such as our own, in which he never set foot. Now, what I've outlined here are just a few points from four articles. Each of those four articles contain much, deal with many more subjects than what I'm able to mention tonight. And moreover, over the years, Comrade Kim Jong Il published literally dozens of ideological and theoretical articles dealing with almost every area of revolutionary theory and practice. Comrade Kim Jong Il devoted his whole life, as we can see, I believe, even from what I've read out, and the tributes that have been made to him, Comrade Kim Jong Il devoted his whole life not only to the Korean Revolution, but to the World Revolution. He was also, I should say, a sincere and loyal friend and comrade in arms of our party and of the comrades of our party. It was with his support and attention that our party delegations have been able to visit the DPRK, and our comrades have, over the years, received his gifts and the expressions of his friendly feelings towards us on a number of occasions. Tonight represents our formal tribute to Comrade Kim Jong Il. Our ongoing tribute will be, above all, to continue to build our party and to develop our work, as he would undoubtedly have wished. Glory to the memory of our beloved comrade Kim Jong Il.
Thank you, Keith, for that very exhaustive contribution, which brought many things to the knowledge of comrades who might not have known about every one of the theoretical tracks that you cited in this case. Thank you.